all right.
Call to order, please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
See, that'll teach you.
No, it was asthma.
Good evening. Welcome to the February 23rd, 2017 Hillsborough Township Planning Board meeting. This meeting has been duly advertised according to Section 5 of the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, Sunshine Law. Roll call, please.
Mayor Sirachi, absent. Mr. Wagner?
Here.
Committeeman Delcor, absent. Mr. Peason?
Here.
Ms. Forrest?
Here.
Ms. Julian is absent. Ms. Vecarina? Absent. Mr. Hestag?
Here.
Scobo is absent. Mr. Weinstein?
Here.
And Chairman LaPonte?
Here. This evening, we have a relatively short or condensed meeting. We do not believe have any minutes on nor resolutions to approve or amend at this particular time. We do have our first order of business. The Planning Board is going to hear from the Capital Planning Committee. We do have...
Mr. Chairman? Yes, thank you. I will go ahead and be recusing myself from the Capital Planning presentation at this time.
Okay, thank you.
We have a new quorum.
We still have enough for a quorum, according to the counselor. So at this time, we are going to hear from the Chairman of the Capital Planning Committee, Dr. Cerici. So, welcome and thank you.
Do we need to qualify the witness?
I think...
Actually, we may have to have...
Call to order.
We may have to have the witness check for other mental problems, not qualification.
Like, why, after 15 years of still doing this? There's words for that.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's interesting to be sitting on this side of the dais. I have been participating with the Capital Planning Committee since I was first elected to office in 2003 for my only term. And so I'm very familiar with what we've been looking at over the years for the township. And many of the members of the Capital Planning Committee have been serving for quite some time. So year after year, we've been following the progress of things. And I think it's been very good for us in the sense that we can see the progression of the needs as they come forward and understand that if we didn't do something in the past, it's time to do it now, et cetera. So I hope that that's helped us make some good recommendations to the board that allows you to make good recommendations to the Township Committee. We heard from all of the township officials who had requests to make. It was a highly professional presentation by all of them, complete with PowerPoint materials, both written and visual. And it was an excellent informational session about what's needed. And I could also say, and I'm sure all the department heads would say it too, that nobody's presenting to us any fluff. Really, if unlimited funds were available of all the things they requested, you could do them all, and it would be a good deed for the township, because nobody's requesting anything, you know, truly silly, although some requests are perhaps a little premature in terms of which year they need to be done. So in any case, we did rank them, and I'll just go through it briefly what the ranking is. We have, in the last couple of years, taken the roads separately. Road resurfacing projects are very expensive, largely due to the very high price of asphalt. It was shocking to me to learn that asphalt is 95% dirt and rocks, and it's only 5% petroleum product. So I think that when we hear the word oligarchs, we think of Russians or something. There are asphalt oligarchs in this state who are charging an awful lot of money for dirt and rocks. So it's a problem, I think, for all municipalities. we ranked the number one road project to be New Amwell Road. And why is that? Yes, the road is in disrepair, as are some others, but it's what's called a complete street, which in the state planning terms is a street that has sidewalks, bike paths, handicap ramps, the modern storm drains with the markers on them, all the things that, that the state wants a street to have. And therefore, it's eligible for state grant of perhaps up to $200,000. Other roads that we would be that we could and should be doing don't necessarily have that. So we always prioritize the road that can get the state grant. And
excuse the interruption, Dr. Cerisi. Yeah. Let the record show that Ms. Beccarina has joined the meeting.
Thanks. Apologize for the latency.
No. Thank you. Doctor?
Sure. So that is our number one ranked project and road, I believe, because the state grant money is important in defraying maybe 40% of the expense of doing the job. And it is a very heavily traveled road that needs needs redoing. We ranked the other roads as South Triangle Road second, Camp Lane Road third, Clawson Avenue fourth. Clawson Avenue is less trafficked than the other three, and that's the reason. All four of them certainly could use a resurfacing now or soon. South Triangle Road obviously is heavily trafficked and serves a church, an elementary school, and pretty much around the corner the middle school. And Camp Lane Road serves residential areas and industrial areas that gets heavy truck traffic. So that was the reason for the ranking. In terms of the non-road projects, the number one ranked project was culvert replacements. There are a couple of places in the township where culverts, which are basically, they could be square if they're old enough or rounded, water passageways underneath roads. And if you're driving up on the road, you may not realize that there's water that needs to pass underneath. And culverts can collapse over time. And we have a couple of culverts, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, that may be a century or more old, really, and are now in a state of collapse, which means that ultimately the road will fall into the culvert. So this is a very big safety problem. So the culvert replacements, which literally it needs a complete redo, are the number one ranked project from engineering at $175,000 to completely replace two of them. The number two project is a safety issue as well, and it's also, and this is why it's good for us to have consistency from year to year, it's a five-year project, and that is to replace damaged, broken, in some places missing old wooden guardrails with modern metal guardrails in various more dangerous curves and stretches of road in the township. So we're partway through that project, and we really think it needs to be seen through on its five-year plan to get all of those replaced so that all of these areas have the proper modern guardrails. And that's a $100,000 project. Next, we rank the network server upgrade, which keeps this building open. As we all know, any of us who work in business, government, or anywhere, you need your computers to do work nowadays. And if the network servers are gone, so are you and the, what you can do. So as it was explained to us by Mr. Horry, our IT chief, that these servers are beyond any reasonable maintenance, so they need to be replaced. Number four was to finish another job, which is resurfacing the right side of the skate park at Ann Van Middlesworth. There is a bit of a safety issue because cracks running through the pavement of a skating park are not the best thing. Granted, that's not as serious as motor vehicle safety because it's much further to fall at a slower rate of speed. But again, it's a project that's midway through because part of the park has been refurbished and it, the project should be finished. So that also caused us to rank it higher as well as a potential for injury. Number five, the automated salt brine maker for public works. Although I may be a Republican, I am not, however, a climate denier. And because I remember snow as a child, and we just really don't see it anymore, except when we do. And when we do, we need this stuff badly. And while this township years ago demoed a salt brine maker that gave other townships the idea to get them, we never got one ourselves, a real one. And now we're behind the other townships in the ability to make salt brine. If we have our own salt brine maker, not only do we save a lot of labor, not only do we make it much better and quicker for us to keep the roads from icing over, but we can even sell salt brine to others who don't have salt brine makers. So it's a potential pay for itself, at least in part, type of thing. Six, the compact high density record storage system has to do with police records, which is not a direct safety issue, except that what the police do is public safety, and their records room is overstuffed at this point and untenable going forward in terms of more capacity. So this is the sort of thing that, as a radiologist, I know X-ray rooms, film storage rooms used to have, where you wind up and the big cabinets go like this so that they can all stack together, or you can create a space if you have to go down a particular line and see what's in the cabinets on either side. And it's the way that X-ray films were always stored. It's all digital now. But for police records, it's not all digital, particularly historical material, and this would allow them to do what they need to do. After that, we have a couple of trucks, one for Public Works, one for Park and Rec. They're both F-450s. The Public Works one has a little bit more of the add-ons, which is why it's a little bit more expensive in terms of the amount of things they can attach to the truck. These things are workhorses. During a snowstorm, they're workhorse plow and spreaders. But for the rest of the year, they're workhorse in terms of doing your land maintenance for both Public Works and Parks, who have to do both. And number nine is, and I think this was getting towards the end of the high priority, was picnic tables, benches, grills, and swing set at Ann Van. Now again, this seems like a complete luxury item, except the township puts a lot, it's both Ann Van and Doherty Park. The township's put a lot of resources into making Ann Van our premier park, and also to making Doherty Park a nice place. And yet, at this point, these simple amenities are rotting away. And this would give the Parks and Rec Department the ability to get those synthetic ones that won't rot away, and also to get new grills, and to turn them into the truly, top-level parks in all of what they can offer. I mean, you can redo a skate park, you can put up a dog park, you can do the fields beautifully, but people don't even have tables and benches to sit at. You know, it's not the best thing. And the other thing that we thought is it's only, $10,000 or less. In fact, I think Mr. Wagner can probably do it for less than $9,700 and do a pretty good job with it. The sidewalk replacements, which traditionally we put at the middle as we go transition from high priority to medium priority, the sidewalk replacements are, again, an every year thing. The difference now is that we're running low on sidewalk funds. So this may actually be something that would come out of the main township budget rather than a dedicated fund contributed to by developers. I don't know. We don't know the status of the fund exactly. That's something that the CFO would know. But this is something, again, that we've done every year since I've been involved 14 years ago. And you have to do sidewalk replacements because they don't last forever either. Then number 11, I do really want to explain the traffic signal modifications. Now we were told, and this is at a particular intersection, which is Triangle and Orton Road. Okay, if you can think about that, where the CVS is. The issue apparently is that in making a left turn from Triangle to Orton in either direction, kind of like that, sight lines are poor and there have been accidents. So the Capital Planning Committee was told, well, the number of accidents per year has reached a level where action is indicated according to the state DOT. So I've learned in my business, you always have to ask the quantitative question. Okay, how many is that exactly? And the answer is 4 per year. So it's not like there's an accident every day there that we have an ongoing horrific calamity. But for some reason, in some standard, having four of this type of accident per year, and these are low-speed accidents, so you're not talking about fatality, serious injury, just talking about angry people and damaged cars. Four times a year, somebody is missing the sight line here, and you're getting a left-turn accident. The sight lines in the other direction, if you're on Orton and trying to make a left turn onto Triangle, are not that bad. So the problem, and if you look at the Chief Powell's statistics, the problem's in the one direction, really. So what the original proposal to the Capital Planning Committee was for $270,000 to do specific left turn signals in all directions. And the idea being you have to take down the stanchions that are there as well as the lights and put up completely new lights and stanchions and drill holes underneath the street for all the electrics for all of this, and that it would end up costing that much money. Well, the point was is that was a non-proportional response to the problem. The problem's in one direction, so the response should be in one direction. And if you limit the response to doing the left turn signal just from Triangle onto Orton, you address the problem and save more than half the money. And that would bring that down to $126,000 from the original proposal. The other thing was how you do a left turn signal. You can do a left turn signal that's protected, in which the green left arrow goes, people turn left, and then that goes red, and then the main green light goes on, and you can't make a left turn anymore. That's called that's a protected left turn. That is unnecessary at that intersection. Think about yourself there at 9:30 at night, and you're pulling up you could make a left turn. There's nobody in either direction, and you're sitting there because you got this protected left turn as if you're on 7th Avenue in New York City. So the way to do it, and Chief Powell explained this to us, is what's called a protected permitted. If you do have two lines of traffic, the left turn comes on first while the main light is red. This allows the two lines of traffic that want to turn left to safely turn left and get out of the way. That clears the sight lines, and then you can have what's called permitted. Green light, no red on the left, and people can make a left turn because their sight line isn't clogged anymore because you've left the lined up, you let the lined up cars go and get out of the way first. So the recommendation is for a protected permitted left turn signal just facing Triangle Road to eliminate the problem of the Triangle Road to Orton Road left turn. Okay? and that's what the committee is recommending to yourselves and to the township committee. After that, we rank things from, medium, which is another dump truck for public works, a smaller truck for parks and rec, a new mower for parks and rec, culvert pedestrian bridge repairs. These are things that are not critical. These are culverts and a pedestrian bridge over 206 that are not in any way critical at this time. Remote control lighting at AVM and Doherty Park, which is a labor-saving device, because the lights can be turned on and off manually. Installing a new fueling facility at Public Works. I passed over demolished PID building and replaced with pavilion and park amenities. The PID property is out there behind Public Works towards, that way. And it's an open space property that was purchased some years ago. And it was really truly open, not like a dense scrub forest, but truly open space. And it could really become a nice park for jogging, biking, even for cross-country racing. My youngest son was now at college. When he was in high school, was on the cross-country team. And the Hillsborough cross-country team's home meets were held in Natterar because we have no facility to run a cross-country meet. When the kids would practice, they could go to Otto Farm Park out in Western Hillsborough, but often you'd see them running along the street, Amwell Road and et cetera. So there was really no place for them to go that was a true cross-country running facility. We don't know when such things will happen at Mountain View Park, because Mountain View Park's gonna be staged, and the first stage is gonna be the ball fields. So we don't know when the stage of doing the trails is gonna be done. So it would be really nice to have the ability to demolish the cruddy old building that's there and replace it with a pavilion and park amenities and begin the process maybe of turning that into a jogging, running, bicycling type of park, even something that can host cross-country matches, maybe not the giant matches, but, you know, bilateral matches, two school matches. So we put that lower because obviously there's nothing urgent about it, but it would be a nice thing to do at some point. The new fueling facility, which I started to talk about, would be Public Works' worries about their access to the county facility. On the other hand, the county facility is in Hillsborough, so it's actually rather nice for us that it's here, and we didn't think that that was an urgent priority. A new bus for social services. They did get a new bus a year or two ago, and their older bus is still serviceable, so this is one of the things where we thought, yeah, sure, down the road, you're going to need another bus, but not this year. And then the canopy at the municipal building on the west side had to do with people, particularly if seniors are there or something, waiting. The problem is that the canopies could cause more problems than they're worth, and it would be a lot cheaper to issue each senior citizen an umbrella of their own, quite frankly, than to build and try to maintain a canopy, which could be destroyed anytime there's a strong wind. And believe me, it was explained to us what the problem with these canopies can be. So that one was our last, not because we want seniors to get wet, but actually, really, it'd be a lot cheaper, about one-tenth the cost or less, and more effective to issue everybody a free umbrella as a thing.
Poncho.
So that's the list. Obviously, you know, we got a lot of excellent supportive materials. I want to, on behalf of the committee, again thank the department heads, I assume many of whom, I saw a few, yes, a number of whom were behind me. Obviously, any questions that you guys have, I'm sure they'd be happy to answer questions too, more in depth than I could, but any questions about, you know, what we did as a committee, I'd be happy to or explain anything else, I'd be happy to do.
Thank you, Doctor, and thank the board and the committee for the work that it does. It's always difficult to put a laundry list of things, like you said, that the town could use in an orderly fashion, knowing from both sides of the dais you've been on, the budget constraints that this town is on and tries to keep our taxes at a useful and manageable level. I don't have any questions on, but any of the other board members have anything on the rankings that were put out? Or?
Oh, no. I have a question about
sure.
the first one.
Sure.
I don't know if it's appropriate for you to answer, but yeah. The first project, you said you might be there might be grant money available.
Yes.
So that's through Complete Streets. Is that through the Department of Health or the Department of Transportation?
I think that's Transportation.
DOT.
Yeah, and if you do have technical questions, Tom Bellinger's here, and he would ask them, because he goes through the application
up,
for this grant every
Got
year.
It. Yeah, I was just curious if, like, we had received grant money in the past for projects
have.
Like that. Okay.
Tom could tell you how that works.
Tom Bellinger is our engineer.
Tom Bellinger, I'm the assistant town
Hi.
Engineer.
How are you?
Yeah, well, New Amwell Road, we get a grant. We apply for grants every year through
right.
the DOT. And New Amwell, this is phase three of New Amwell Road.
Oh, I see.
I broke it into three phases, and we received two grants already. Phase one, phase two was last year and the year before.
Okay.
And the reason I broke it into three phases, because we usually get about $175,000 to $200,000 a year through the DOT
for each phase. Oh, okay.
So if I put it as one project and it was $3 million, I
right.
probably would still only get $200,000. So
it.
I break it into phases so we can maximize the amount of money that we
okay.
get.
Understood.
And this is very highly that we would receive this because it's a phased project. They usually do grant phased projects.
Okay. Thank you.
Tom, why don't you explain for the board, when you do the culverts that were on top of the non-road projects, what's entailed in doing that? Are you ripping the whole road up? Or are you pulling out the pipe that we saw in the grass? I mean, explain to the board what it entails
well,
to do those projects.
The culvert replacements, those are the old, like indicated, they're the old metal culverts that are corroded. Yeah, they would be a complete replacement. So they'd have to be removed and replaced. And actually, after our meeting, we had one of them, which was number one on my list, where the culvert actually failed. And it, luckily, it wasn't on one of the, it's right off of Wurtsville Road, back to our open space. It wasn't on the main road. So we had to have emergency plates put out there and so forth to support it. And we could only use it for small, light vehicles and so forth. But yeah, those would be rip up the entire road and replace it. The culvert repairs, those are culverts that there's some slab, you know, they might be concrete box culverts, and they got concrete slabs on the top, and some of the slabs are cracked and broken, and they can be repaired. They can go in there and pour a new slab. I mean, we might have to close the road for a while and do some repairs.
When you do the culvert replacements, obviously you're pulling out that old corrugated pipe.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What are we putting in this place? Are we putting the same technology, or what are we doing?
No, usually the ones on the road, we will replace it with either concrete, or they have new plastic pipes now. The one that just failed, we are going to replace it with corrugated aluminum pipe. It's on a smaller driveway type road, and if I start replacing it with a different type of pipe, that requires a major permits through DEP, because now you're changing the flow characteristics of the pipe. Mm-hmm. So we're going to replace it in kind and do it as a maintenance contract. Okay. Then we don't have to go through the whole permit process. But some of these other ones, we will, if we have time and they don't collapse and we have the time to go, we would redesign it, put concrete in, or the plastic, which would get a life expectancy of a lot more than the old metal ones.
Thank you. Any other questions on that?
Just maybe real quick. So South Triangle, was that on the list last year, as I
yes.
recall?
That, it didn't... Actually, South Triangle has been on the list for the last three or yeah. 4 years.
Yeah, all right.
And it doesn't get funded through the committee.
And it's not eligible for the grant because it's not a complete road or other criteria?
That it's not as complete streets. Complete streets, they like to have bike lanes, sidewalks. Right. That's... would maybe make it, but very highly unlikely to
okay.
make the grant.
So it might be a close call between one and two, almost, because it is damaged as well, and it's very active with
yeah.
the school. And
yeah.
So, all right.
I mean, every year in the future, like now, next year, if we get new Amwell, Beekman Lane, if you see right out here by the municipal building, that's also complete streets. It has bike lanes, bike sidewalks. That road's falling apart also. That will probably be very highly... doable to get a grant money.
Ken, I got to say, it's a slippery slope with the roads. You fall more behind every year, and Tom always
yeah.
tells us on capital
every
planning. Year. And my rant is that while again I'm pretty Republican and conservative in most ways, I'm an outright Marxist where it concerns asphalt production. I believe the plant should be seized for the good of the state and the people, and operated in the public benefit.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because this really is a strategic resource, yeah. because being able to get from one place to another is essential in our economy, and until we have Jetson-style flying cars, we need to do that on the ground over asphalt.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have an oligopoly of oligarchs who control this strategic resource and make it unaffordable to the taxpayer, you got a big problem. And it's not just Hillsborough. It's everywhere, particularly in those states that still have winter.
Right. But they can't. There's no competition in the.
They. I mean, look at the application you guys had.
Mm-hmm.
There was an objector, right? The objector was one of the oligarchs who was trying to stop competition from being built. So there's very little competition,
yeah.
actually. And the problem is that. A substance that's 95% dirt and rocks is priced like gold,
yeah,
and
coming.
You can't afford to do it. Bridgewater, a couple of years ago, bonded $4 million just to do road resurfacing, regular road resurfacing. And it's probably something that they're going to find they're going to have to do again
yeah.
Soon, mm-hmm. you know? And if every municipality starts going down that road,
that's
a pun, no pun intended. You're gonna be building up a lot of debt in local government. Never mind what our state government's got, which is already basically bankrupt. But our local governments are gonna get in the same pickle because somehow you've got to continue to allow people to get from one place to another while trying to afford to pave your streets with dirt and rocks and a little bit of tar binder.
Yeah, and there's ways, you know, we are looking into ways. There are some sealers and coatings and all you can put on roads to try to preserve them for a longer length of time, which we are looking into. But sometimes even when you do those cost-benefit ratios and you put a coating on there and that you get only 5 years out of it and it starts flaking off and so forth, you sometimes when you figure it out, you're still better off milling and repaving a road every 15 to 20 years. And with the amount of roads we have in town here, we have over 250 miles of roads. I calculated one time if we put all of our roads on a 20-year cycle, we would need $4 to $5 million a year in road paving if we wanted to keep up with that cycle. So we're completely falling behind.
Yeah. Other than the Complete Streets model, is there another grant available through the Department of Transportation or maybe one of the other state departments that might be available to our township?
It's the only
That's the only thing.
That's the only one that we've looked into that's available for road paving. I mean, there are some other ones out there. I did apply. There's transportation enhancement grants that are out there, which try to, you know, some of it you can go into paving and try to enhance, but we tried for those grants. We were never eligible
just
for them.
Okay.
Thank you, Stephanie.
You're welcome.
Just as a question on this traffic signaling.
Yeah.
When that road is built and engineered, do they not take into consideration growth and put those left turn signals in? I mean, who makes that call when you build a road to have a to build it with a left turn signal there instead of adding it after the fact?
Well, you got to remember, Triangle Road was built kind of like hodgepodge, built and it kept getting built in pieces as the developers built, you know, because that the road was built almost free of no cost to the town because as the developers built Row Hill, I think, built in there, and Majestic Knolls, all these developers, they kept building Triangle Road in pieces. When they lined up at that intersection there, it's just a straight line up, and it's actually not bad if there's cars in line. It's when you have a truck or something. You have a truck, you really can't see, you know,
the sight line,
the cars
yeah,
coming straight on there because it's actually a straight line road and you get that a lot
with a median
it's just the way it is.
It's
lined
got a
up.
slight curve too.
Yeah, there's
ever
a slight
so
curve.
Slight enough to give that shadowing
it does you. On the 206 side like
so that you know, that as soon as there's four accidents a year on average it kicks into an automatic report.
Well, I don't know. I mean, Chief Powell could tell you what the maybe what the criterion is. And I said also, do I care what a bureaucrat in Trenton thinks is a trigger point? Like,
sometimes
as if that guy behind a desk actually knows.
Before,
I mean, but the problem is that the township committee also hears from all of the participants in those accidents, you know? And it's if it can be prevented by a targeted and economically sensible intervention, then that doesn't go beyond what it needs to do and doesn't cost more than it needs to cost, then it's something you consider doing.
What's that?
The, what the signaling there.
The signal, the left turn.
So that
we do a protected, permitted left turn only in the Triangle Road direction.
Right.
Rather than the original proposal, which was everything.
I was going to add a comment on this because like I was curious because I read it and I think I read Mr. Mazur recommended that it would be a good idea. And how you described it, I agree 100% with. Right. And I was curious about the number of accidents. But more than just the number of accidents, I think the peace of mind for a lot of people that make that turn, they're, you know, you're glad when you get through it and a car didn't come speeding down the... Because I do it all the time. If you've had kids in Orton Road, you know, you've probably dealt with it a lot. So I think a lot of people would be glad to see that done,
you know,
not
and,
just
and
the ones
twice,
that have the
twice a day during the school year, I'm sure that the school buses would appreciate being able to make that turn from, you know, going eastbound on Triangle to get up to Orton Road School. And I think that that's fine, but when we originally saw $270,000, all four directions, even though there weren't really accidents in the other direction, plus this protected left turn, I mean, what? This is again. This isn't 7th Avenue and 14th Street. You know.
I was gonna.
So That was crazy, and we questioned that. And you know, and Chief Powell's like, well, you know, what you're saying is reasonable.
Right.
You know, do it in only one direction, cut the cost. And, of course, we have also the privilege and pleasure of having Bob Heibel on the Capital Planning Committee. So, I mean, what a great advisor for us to have there. And there's real gravitas to Bob, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean,
yeah.
And he was completely, you know, thought that was a completely reasonable approach as well. So,
so we cut that cost down to the bone.
Yeah, I was just more concerned, like, how the lights are built to begin with. That they, you know, there are other lights. I'm sure that you drive around Hillsborough and wonder why there isn't a left-hand turn signal on, you know, and you're sitting the backup, the queuing of cars forever because there's a lot of left-hand turns.
Well, when I moved here in '97. Yeah. There wasn't a light at the intersection of New Amwell and Auton.
Mm-hmm.
And I drove up there one day with my then very young twins, and what I believe was a fatal accident had occurred.
Mm.
Now, I could recognize the blood,
mm-hmm.
but my little guys, I told them, well, you know, she's probably at the grocery store and it, you know, bought a lot of tomato sauce or something. And, you know, years later, they bust my child. You really told us that, Dad? I says, well, you know, you were like 4 years old. What do you want me to tell you? And I remember the helicopter coming in to evacuate the poor victim of that accident and everything. And I remember, and I said to the cop, what the, you know, and he said, we've been telling them they need a light here, you know? So, you know, so that's how a light gets built, you know, mm-hmm. when there wasn't one.
Right.
But as Tom's telling you, Triangle Road was built in pieces.
Mm-hmm.
There was the forward vision of Pete Biondi that should be a four-lane road because of the future growth of the township. But to do that just as one planned chunk would have been an enormous expense.
Right.
So getting the developers to do it in pieces, and when you do that, the developers are not going to do the premium job.
No.
With all the left turn signals and all the, you know, bells and whistles. They're going to do the basic job. And then later on, as you get your statistics, you realize, well, you know, there's a problem in this direction. It's not horrific, but nevertheless, it could stand to be addressed. So we just wanted to make sure that it was addressed in an economical and very directed way that wasn't overburdensome and overexpensive.
I agree. Thank you. Anything else? Thank you, Tom.
Okay.
We have a motion to open to public on the testimony given.
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
All in favor? Aye. So anyone in the public have any questions on to Dr. Cerisi or any of the professionals that are here? Seeing none, we will then motion to close.
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Any other questions for any other professionals? Okay.
I'd just like to remind the chairman that capital planning is an advisory type of group.
Correct.
It has no powers to, make these projects go forward.
That's correct.
And nor are we as a board authorized to pull the trigger on any of these, and it's more of an advisory capacity. So want to make sure that
under the municipal land use law, and Eric will correct me if I'm wrong, I'm sure, the capital planning responsibility goes to the planning board. In Hillsborough, there's a subcontract, as it were, to the capital planning committee to come make recommendations to the planning board.
Mm-hmm.
And we've been doing it that way for a long time. And we do it so that we have a capital planning committee of people know what we're doing and try to give you the best recommendations. You, of course, can change our priority list. And then it's up to the township committee what they want to do or what they don't want to do. We're going to go based on what they want to fund and what they can fund.
Mm-hmm.
So ultimately, it's going to be their decision to fund or not fund things and put them in the capital budget and actually make them happen. So we're just here to help you, in a sense, make your recommendation to them. You can change any of this if you wish. And then they do it, you know, what
as
they want
wish.
And what they think is best.
Absolutely.
I mean, one year when I was chairman of this committee, we changed a number of things.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah,
we
had a lot of lines and moves and arrows.
We moved a lot of things around, and, it happens.
Right.
Now, there are also, when I first started with this, there would tend to be 35, 40 items requested.
Yeah,
it was ridiculous.
Right.
And I think everybody, you know, got down to the point of, look, we're just going to ask for what's necessary. We're going to keep it very straightforward, and it makes everybody's life much easier.
Correct.
So it's been that's been a good development the last few years.
Very good. Thank you. As far as the order, again, you beat me to the punch and all that. So for those who haven't been on this board before, so to read, as the doctor said, this is an advisory board that presents to us. And then we can take this list and we can move, as Dr. Shree said, things up or down. If you feel that for whatever reason, for example, you think that the F-450 for the Mason Duncan number 7 should go down to 15 or something up, either way, you know, this would be the time that we could discuss that. And then we'd send that to the committee, and then they take that into consideration and may completely throw away what we recommend, which probably has happened before. But obviously, I think that the presentation and the thought process on the top, we'll call the priority stuff, the top four on the road projects are all thought out and given reasons why they're that way. And then usually the top five or six are the same way. The, you know, that gray area tends to muddle around where the medium and low projects. If there's anything that you see here or that you might think that you bring up or down at this time, we could discuss that. I actually think the list, in my opinion, is pretty spot on. I think they did a very, very good job at being in that side and on that committee and seeing the list and the roads that need to be done, but also taking into consideration the network server, which I think, you know, if you ever had your computer crash at your office, which I've had the ability of, you're basically, the world does shut down. Actually, even during Sandy, when power goes out, you know, try to have a business run during a hurricane or something to that effect. So it's very, and they're on the emergency services side, so I think that's got to be top and ready to go, in my opinion. And finishing some projects that have been started, again, I agree, you know, the skate park is a minor thing, and other things that have been started, we want to finish projects so that our people can see that it's now off the list and it's not dragging out and costs go up, a.k.a. 206 bypass. just a small dig there. But
yeah.
But we got money, supposedly, so that's coming. So,
woohoo.
Any day. So that's just my thoughts. Is there anything else in the dais that might want to say anything? Stephanie?
I just had just a small question. The compact high-density record storage system, that I remember it from last year. We never... It wasn't like a slow, like, you know, progressive project, or like we did it at, like, a little bit at a time. This we haven't done yet. Correct?
Oh no, you haven't done it yet. With okay. This, with this, you've done. Oh.
Because I remember.
What was done? It was something. It was another room that was done that was changed.
Yeah. Was the evidence?
The evidence
room. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Come on up.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got it. I was just curious.
No, that's okay.
From last
Come on up. There's the difference between the evidence room and the records room.
Got it. Okay.
Explain.
We did the evidence room several years ago with the same system.
Okay.
We ran out of space, and it really helps out
sure.
So we don't have to turn other rooms into storage.
Understood. Thank you.
Lieutenant Kenneth Pryor.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So Lieutenant Pryor showed the committee pictures, which I don't know if you have them.
We
there.
Have them in
we
our
saw
page.
It on
yeah,
the PowerPoint.
Yeah.
Yep. And you got a situation where the rooms become untenable. I know
sure.
that in a hospital environment, you couldn't have a records room
right.
like that. So, and you don't want it in a police situation either. And the system, when you put in this high-density system, it's a single job. They come in and they install the system for the room.
And there's no need to keep the paper copies once they've all been...
Well, that's another thing that
is
Lieutenant
Oh, that is
how,
the
yeah.
that is
that's
okay,
why we have to have
this okay.
system.
You have
I
to
see.
Hold them for what for like 5 years. What was the thing now?
There's depending upon what type of record it is, you can go anywhere from 75 years to you know 7 to 3 to 5.
Wow.
But there's a lot of records we just can't get rid of.
Oh, I see.
And the only other alternative is to convert it to microfilm. Believe it or not, that's still used. We're trying to go to a different system that the Division of Archives Management will approve for that to digitally store them. But we can't get rid of the paper records for numerous years.
Okay. Thank you.
I mean, if you think about microfilm, that was state of the art for Sean Connery's James Bond. You know, in the medical world too, you have legal requirements for records retention, and you get inspected for that. Now, a police department may not get inspected, but you can't take chances with messing up your records.
Understood.
And
Thank you.
The room, really, you've seen the pictures. It's become untenable.
Sure. So all that's going in the existing room that you have now, or you're taking it all out?
Yeah, everything's coming out of there, and hopefully, and the new system's going in, and then we're going to sort it back out and put it in there. Should be a great project to undertake.
I'll be busy that day. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ken, you had some?
No. Okay. No, I mean, I wasn't going to make a change. I just think I like the idea of the picnic tables in the two parks. I mean, they're not a safety issue, but a lot of families enjoy going to the parks. So I think that could have a lot of big impact for a relatively small cost. So
okay.
I like that.
So do we have so I don't hear any real changes. Do we have a motion to approve the list as is?
I'll make the motion.
Okay. Second?
Second.
Do we need a roll call that, or all in favor?
Okay. Roll call.
Roll call, please.
Beeson.
Yes.
Ms. Forrest.
Yes.
Secretary Askew.
Yes.
Ms. Beccarina.
Yes.
Mr. Weinstein.
Yes.
Chairman LaFont.
Yes. Thank you, Chairman. Job well done.
Yes.
My congratulations to your staff also.
Well, capital planning is just 2 meetings, and it's the opportunity for us to all say hi to each other again for another year. So it's good. It's a good thing. So we look forward to doing it again next year.
Yeah. Very good.
Thank you
very
thank
much.
You.
Thank you, Dr. Cerisi.
All right. So we've done that. So then the next thing would be special committee reports, which I don't believe there are any. Then we would have any business from the floor that is not on this agenda. And I see none.
Mr. Chairman, let the record reflect Mr. Wagner is rejoining the dais.
Yes. Welcome back, Mr. Wagner.
From his absence due to his conflict as the Director of Parks and Recreation.
He's fresh
and
off
social
his
services.
And social services.
And social services. Services and
so we are going to revisit the discussion of the consideration of ordinances regulating trucks in residential districts. If you recall, we talked about this in the January meeting. We had some public give some input as to what their particular circumstances are, what their opinions were, and we've had some time, hopefully, to mull that over. And this would be a time, if we have any other thoughts to bring back to this ordinance. David, you want to start?
Yeah, just to kind of pick up where we left off last time, I think the discussion at the last meeting raises many questions, perhaps, as it did provide answers. Some of the, I tried to get a handle on the questions that were raised, and perhaps some questions you might want to consider in whatever shape the ordinance takes. I don't expect an answer, but these are just questions I'll throw out. Do we differentiate between commercial and non-commercial vehicles, for instance? Is the front yard totally off limits for trucks, or do you permit some type of truck, some size, et cetera, with certain restrictions? Are the side and rear yard okay, vis-a-vis the front yard? Should there be some buffer screening requirements? I think a lot of the discussion centered around the vehicle type and size. How big? There was a lot of discussion of gross vehicle weight versus capacity, and certain trucks come at a certain weight, but depending on how you fit them out, the capacity goes up. Which metric should we use? Is it payload capacity or gross vehicle weight? Some of this also has to do with enforcement going forward. Are we going to pick a metric that's, so when the zoning officer gets a call from a neighbor saying there's an illegal truck in someone's driveway, how do we know for sure it is, in fact, above the limit? Do we limit it to one vehicle per property? So those are the questions that have come up. You have the sample or the initial draft of an ordinance that came with the initial memo. We can certainly massage that. Now, tonight I just handed out, and I think it was Bob, you
yeah.
got me onto these. One's from West Orange, and one's from Springfield. And what's interesting about these two is they actually have a permit program. So we can look at West Orange for a minute and turn to page 2. You'll see it says in residential districts. But that won't get into too much of the detail, but it basically, first of all, restricts pickup trucks, vans, equipment related thereto to be stored in any residential district between 9 p.m. and 7 a.m. unless the following conditions. And some of them are similar to what we've been talking about, although in interesting fashion. So 3A, you can have a truck if there is a, if, well, the preference here is to put it in a garage. So if the garage on the if there is a garage on the premises into which the vehicle fits in its stripped down fashion, in other words, without accessories, the vehicle must be parked or stored in the garage. And it goes on to limit it to one per property. If you go down to 3D, if the vehicle is permitted by this section to be parked outside of a garage, all removable equipment such as pipes, pipe racks, ladders, and all racks and equipment must be removed from the vehicle. So the guy brings his truck home and he's got to basically strip it down. I guess you get into a question of where do you put that stuff? Because mm-hmm. I think in the initial draft of the ordinance that I gave you, we said you can't have stuff, equipment stored on the property outside. E is interesting there. If it's parked outside and it has commercial markings, it has to be covered by a blank metallic cover that is the same color as the body. G on the next page, second from the top, they get into where it may be parked in the driveway on the premises in the area of the driveway which is at is least visible from the nearest adjacent street or roadway. It's somewhat subjective. The next one, H, goes on to more of a limitation on size. It can has to be a single axle, not more than 4 wheels. Then they get into dimensions, not more than 20 feet long, 7 feet high, not exceed 6,000 pounds gross vehicle weight, which isn't a particularly big truck.
Not big at all. No.
And if you may recall, if you still have the initial memo I gave you.
Right.
Let me just turn to that for a second.
Page 2 on that.
Yeah. Just so you remember, you know, I said how big is a ton? So they're limiting it to 6,000 pounds of gross vehicle weight. If you look at the table, if you have it on page 2, it's the last column. Almost all of these
are over that.
And you see the pictures on the next page. That small van Ford Transit Connect is about 6,000 pounds. Mm. But the Ford Transit, which comes in cargo and passenger, is 10,000 pounds. The Ford F-150 pickup truck, which is fairly common, is 78. So, again, it's a question of how big is too big. If you have an interesting section towards the middle of that page, H-I-J-K-L, under exemption, and I'm not sure how it works, if it exempts them from everything else, but it actually provides the zoning official or the planning director's designee, and I'm not asking you to do that, that there's an exemption if it meets all these other things. In particular, one, the commercial vehicle is properly registered. That's pretty simple. But then it says that the appearance of the vehicle is clean, free of all graffiti, exterior is finely finished, and all the other criteria are met. That's fairly subjective, I guess. Mm-hmm. And then the one underneath that, though, does get into placement. The size of the driveway is sufficient or appropriate, sufficient size to permit the vehicle to be parked within 3 feet of paving, with 3 feet of paving on each side, and at least 20 feet from the sidewalk or the curb or the street, whichever is further. So there you're, to some extent, prohibiting it in the front yard. You've got to be 20 feet from the sidewalk, depending on the size of the property, obviously. But as I mentioned on the last page, there are 8. They actually have a payment of a permit fee of $50, and you get a sticker, you put it on the bumper, and so anybody who's enforcing it would know it's a permitted vehicle. Now, Springfield's a little bit shorter, a little more direct, and it's a totally a permit system. The vehicle has to display commercial, it has to display, let me back up a second. Commercial vehicle shall mean regardless of weight, any bus, step van, cargo van, tow truck, dump truck, box truck, bulldozer, backhoe, taxi, limousine, or motorhome, or any vehicle or trailer used for commercial purposes, regardless of registration, in other words, whether it has commercial plates or not, or any vehicle displaying commercial advertising or external equipment. So then it goes on to say you can make an application. Any resident seeking to park such a vehicle in a residential zone or a residential property must obtain a commercial vehicle permit from the township. You have to fill out a form with the clerk's office. There's an application fee of $100. And it has to be supported by the following: proof that the vehicle is registered, photograph of the vehicle, and proof that the resident either owns or has legal right to drive the vehicle. So saying you can have it, pretty much what we talked about before in terms of it, you have to live there. But what was interesting in this one, and I think, Sean, you might have questioned how this might work, 4-5.3 notice. So when the clerk gets the application, a notice is sent to everybody within 200 feet of that property. And unless you have unanimous agreement from the neighbors, you don't get the permit. So I thought that was sort of interesting, which probably, I mean, the reason we've been talking about this is because neighbors have called and complained. So I'm not sure how many people would get that. So if they have the consent of the owners, if you look at the backside, permit fee of $75. You get a permit sticker put on your window. It's good for 1 year. You renew it for $75, etc. So the only reason I brought those up, it's another way of approaching this. I would say, I guess from an enforcement standpoint, having some sort of sticker on a truck saying, all right, we know it's there, it's okay, that helps. But it still probably doesn't get you answers to, all right, what kind of trucks get these stickers? When do you, what's okay to park,
what's
and where do you park it? So I'm sorry I don't have a whole lot of answers for you. But
I had some notes that I took and I kind of broken down to, because you could have a commercial vehicle, i.e. one of those nice little vans or cars that have all the wrap on it that might say Smoothie King. Great place in Hillsborough, you should go.
Yeah.
It's considered a commercial vehicle, but it's basically a car wrapped.
Right.
So I said, is it commercial versus, you know, what I would call construction? Construction to me is something that really doesn't belong in a residential neighborhood. Those are the larger dump trucks. They usually aren't very appealing. They're probably beat up. A commercial vehicle, a pickup truck, a guy's one van or whatever. That's how he actually, you know, he's a plumber. That's his business. He works out of his home, or he has to take a van home because he's on call. Again, and it all comes down to enforcement and your neighbors. Are they going to complain? And I call it the eye test. Does that look like it belongs there? I don't think anything should be parked on lawns. I think it should be on a driveway or behind the house. A lot of homes, like my house, the garage was built up in the 60s, and I could put a bicycle in it. That's about it. I can't fit a car in there. But and the other part of that, is it transportation or is it function? I mean, is it this guy's truly his vehicle that he uses every day as his work? Is he an inspector or whatever? Or is it a storage because he just doesn't want to go buy a yard somewhere and it's cheaper to keep it at his house?
Mm-hmm.
And then my last question is, neighborhood, is it a residence, or you have some people that came that live in the condos or whatever, and they have to park their van in a group parking lot, so they don't have a garage to put it in, they don't have a place to put all this stuff in storage, so yet those people, you know, not to stereotype any, but you know, they tend to be the working class and more likely to have that type of vehicle, or be in that industry. So I think the permit idea, it helps in the fact that you have maybe a way of keeping track of what vehicles are putting in people's driveways. I'm not necessarily a big fan of making people pay a lot of money for a permit, because now it looks like we're just trying to be beat up on the small business guy. But at least it allows the code enforcer an easy way to say, listen, just come get a permit. I know your vehicle's here. And then I can say to the neighbor who may not be complaining, he meets the criteria, he has a sticker, he's permitted to be there, or listen, you got a permit for one vehicle, you got three vehicles here, help me out, you know, issue a warning or whatever. because I think ultimately you want to make it fair, but you want to make it enforceable. And David, whoever has to go out there, it has to make it simple enough to enforce.
Sure.
So those are the thoughts I had, and not necessarily an answer, but you know, a construction vehicle versus commercial vehicle. I think that's kind of the crux of the question here is what can someone put in their driveway that isn't obtrusive to the neighbors?
David, I have a question. I don't know, maybe you can answer this or not. What is the volume of complaints that we get on a, I don't know, yearly, monthly basis? I mean,
Yeah, I don't think it's at a daily basis. It's, for whatever reason, it's picked up recently.
Okay.
They do go back. Some of the genesis to this was that over time, and there was some appeal to a board. You saw what the ordinance says now. There's
sure.
really no mention of commercial vehicles, but it's
correct.
Been, for whatever reason, enforced over the years as no commercial vehicles on a residential property. We were called on it recently, and sure enough, the person was correct. It was the gentleman who was at the last meeting. It doesn't
sure.
say you can't have a commercial vehicle. However, it does say if you're under a ton, you can't basically be there. And
right.
then, and based on our discussions, a ton isn't what it used to be.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So, yeah, we're not overwhelmed with them, but it is an issue, and it does get emotional, if you will, mm-hmm. with the party's concern, both from the person who's calling it in and the person who legitimately, mm-hmm. you know, a contractor. That's his, as the chairman just said, it's his legitimate transportation to work.
Mm-hmm.
It's not, like you say, just we yeah. don't want to rent a yard somewhere. So,
I mean, I guess
overburdened with it, but it may grow. And again, because
yeah.
some of it, again, we get into this commercial, non-commercial. Personal pickup trucks are pretty big.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, you can have an F4, you know, F350
yeah.
with 36-inch tires on it, and
right.
I mean, the thing is huge. You know, it's four doors,
yeah.
but that's my personal vehicle.
Right.
You know, what do you do with that when it's parked outside?
Yeah.
Just
saying. About those type of vehicles,
I'm sorry.
The people complain. The complaints that we get are from those type of vehicles. The pickup trucks.
Not so. It's more the box truck, the plumber,
right.
the electrician.
With
that
the,
type of truck, it might have a ladder on it, but it has the sign, you know,
yeah.
so-and-so plumbing or
sure.
contract or whatever. Not, I'm not aware of getting any complaints about personal
pickup trucks.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, yeah. if you take a literal reading of the ordinance, you could make a case that they're not permitted.
Right.
Because based
right.
totally on weight, on
right.
capacity.
Yeah.
I have a thought. So I agree. I had the same thought about like townhomes, multifamily, like dwellings, condos, things like that. I mean, how, with regard to like the Springfield ordinance you showed us, or even West Orange, is it specific as to whether or not it's for a single family property, or, you know, because you said that one of them, like you would have to notify the neighbors within 100 feet or 200 feet. I mean, how would you do that with like a, you know, like a condo or a townhome? I mean, I live in a townhome, and I
yeah.
know that my husband parks his car in a different spot every night because we only have one allotted spot. And I know in other townhome and condo neighborhoods in Hillsborough, they may not necessarily have a reserved spot. So how do you then, you know, figure that out and
mm-hmm.
go about, you know, notifying the proper, you know, do you notify everybody in the neighborhood? I mean, it just seems like
yeah.
a lot to impose on the township.
Yeah.
That's just my...
Yeah, the West Orange ordinance, it specifically says residential districts and residential properties. Now, they do have that one clause in there. If the resident is multifamily, which would include townhouses and multifamilies and gardens, et cetera,
mm-hmm.
and I'm not sure how they came up with this, but there can only be one ungaraged commercial vehicle per property.
Okay.
So if you have 40, 50, 60 units, means you can only have one commercial vehicle. I suppose that's what it's saying.
Mm.
So meaning only one
per household.
One
well,
per
it says
household.
Per property here, but
well,
I mean you could.
I'm assuming property is the.
Well,
individual.
Yeah, it's a multifamily. If it's a multifamily property, it's a property. So that would require some interpretation.
Yeah. Okay.
That's lawyerese making gray.
Got it.
The problem, frankly, folks, this is becoming a bigger and bigger problem in a number of the municipalities we represent, as people are now tending to bring them home. Why does my neighborhood look like a either a running advertisement for various vendors, and or I'm in a residential community, why am I seeing, and not just the box trucks, any truck, any pickup, anything with sign, I mean, there are towns that define commercial vehicles as any vehicle with a signage on it that advertises a business. I didn't move to fill in the blank to look down my street and it looks like, you know, a parking lot for the commercial vehicle. Because people's livelihoods have changed. People used to not take the cars home from work except, you know, rarely. Now it's become more of the, and more, and it's, to some extent it's also tying in, and in many of these cases it ties in to running commercial businesses in residential districts.
I agree. That's where.
That, you know, either it is already, it is creeping in already, or that will be the next step in. If you let them park the vehicles on their property, the next thing they'll want to do is run their businesses out of their house. Mm-hmm. So there is no simple answer. And, you know, some of you know I represent North Plainfield, where a number of people don't have driveways, don't have garages.
Park on the street.
The borough ordinance forbids you from parking a commercial vehicle on the street in a residential neighborhood, so we have people parking on lawns and in all sorts of happy little places, and we try to deal with that, and that's been this whole separate issue. But, you know, part of it is, you know, on having not looked at the ordinance for the township per se, one way to deal with it is to basically take them off the street, not permitting them at all on vehicles in a residential neighborhood, and hoping the people will put them in their garages, mm-hmm. or at least in the driveway where it's not as visible as right. simply parking it in front of the house.
Right.
I think one of the questions that I have in looking at this and looking at what West Orange has and Springfield with the stickers or with the permits is the ability to balance. That's an additional workload that currently is not being done by some department here at the township. And then you have now the enforcement of that. Currently somebody does not go around and check stickers in the township, but now that would become part of their duties to do that. So, I mean, is the resources able to match what the proposal would be? So it sounds well and nice, yeah, we're going to come up with a permit system like your dog licensing. Hmm. Everybody's supposed to come in and get a license for your dog.
Permit system can be run through a specific agency, and the enforcement issue in many places is spread out over all of the various enforcing groups, whether it's the police department, the zoning officer, the construction department, anyone who sees a vehicle that doesn't have the necessary, and while I think a lot of towns went to the permit system, is to deal with just that issue, where we know I no longer have to make the call, is it or isn't it? If it's got a sticker, it is. If it doesn't have a sticker, it isn't. And since everybody has to have a sticker, you're in violation because you don't have a permit.
Well, I guess, Mr. Bernstein, you know, saying that everybody's going to be responsible for that is one way of looking at it. I think traditionally with our dog licensing, it's handled by the tax department. And they come up once a year, and the line, you know, is at the door when the kids get their parking permits for the high school. The parents and kids are lined up at 7 o'clock in the morning. So I understand what you're saying, but I think it kind of comes back to, okay, is it a feel-good thing because we're addressing something, but we're not really going to be able to enforce it, but we have it on the books in case we need to. I think we need to balance that.
Well,
that's why I asked David, you know, are we getting inundated with, you know, are we getting 20 a month? Are we getting 20 a year?
Yeah, no, I don't even know if it's that many, but I think, well, first of all, to some extent, on a situation like this, let's say we had a sticker system, and even with the complaints we're getting, we are somewhat reactive, we're not proactive. We're not out there looking, we had stickers, we wouldn't be having somebody driving up and down the streets checking stickers.
Correct.
If somebody calls into us, first step, somebody calls and says there's an illegal truck in my neighbor's driveway. Uh-huh. Well, we can ask, is there a sticker? Well, yes. Well, I'm sorry, but they've met all the requirements. There's nothing, you know. Uh-huh. Is there a sticker? No. We get in touch with that person. They can come in and apply, and if they meet all the conditions, they get their sticker. Uh-huh. So it would be more on a, and if you have a block where nobody cares uh-huh. that this truck is in the driveway, no one's going to call, and they probably won't have stickers.
Sure.
But it's a way to get a handle on it, I guess. Uh-huh. Like, yeah, fortunately, it's not a big deal right now, but as Eric says, it's probably something that will grow over time. Uh-huh. And
well, no, I mean, I agree. I mean, with certain towns that Eric had mentioned, yes, I mean, they're built out. There's no additional open space. There's no more development. You know, some of the towns, there's just no room. And I understand that. I don't think that's the case here in Hillsborough. And I guess, you know, my question is, is it of such an importance that we need to address it, which obviously apparently it is, and if you say the numbers are warranted of that, then becomes the enforcement issue. Okay, you know, we're going to require people to get a sticker, and your department heads, if the police go out, or your parks people go out, or your tax people go out, and now you have people going out and enforcing that and saying, oh, you don't have a sticker, and I'm going to summons you, or you have to come in and get a sticker. Somebody's got to assume. Well, that is work.
The enforcement, actually, the enforcement power in many of these sure. is spread out amongst all of the people who can write tickets, because we don't want the zoning officer. I'll give you an example.
Sure.
We have an ongoing dispute over the years about who can go on private property. Mm-hmm. The people carrying shouldn't. The people not carrying should. An item that sort of never yeah. grasped in my mind why I would let somebody who's not on somebody's private property, but those who are allowed to, yes. don't.
Yeah.
This probably would be set up in such a way that if anybody saw it, it wouldn't be like we would have somebody driving around town, as I think David afforded, okay. whether it's Patrick or anybody else, driving around town going, do you, don't you, do you, don't you. But I also don't want it to be, I think, mm-hmm. what you, if you're going to go in this direction, I'm sure. not saying you are. You want to give as many people the opportunity, because the zoning office only works 8:30 to 4:30 Monday to Friday. This one only works, et cetera, et cetera. And inevitably, these calls come on the weekends
sure.
and at night. Uh-huh. And there's nobody's coming out here, because by the time they get out at 8:30 in the morning, the truck is gone.
Absolutely.
So you got to at least give law enforcement, whether they like it or not, some of those powers that come with it. Assuming you want to imbue them with those.
Now, the permits will be issued, will be a one-time, will be a permanent. I would think not something that they will be required to renew every year.
That's
and provided that they give you a picture of the vehicle, and you assign the vehicle with the permit number, or I don't know. Then that should be enough, because even if a police officer or whoever is doing the what do you call inspection, they could use the image. These days, I mean, you have technology. You
I'll
could
tell you in Springfield, it's annual.
View the picture, view the number, so the way you know that it hasn't been transferred to another vehicle, you know, mm-hmm. whatever.
Springfield is annual, folks.
Yeah, Springfield. Yeah.
I thought I saw one at five years.
West Orange, I think, is 5 years, but Springfield, they want it annually.
I think
to discourage people.
Excuse me?
I think an annual permit is done, in many cases, to discourage people from having them.
Right.
Because if I have to spend several hundred dollars over the life of my truck.
To park it there, maybe I'll find something where else to go. You know, those who need to, I guess, would have to. But
a comment on that with Springfield. I have a friend who sits on zoning in Springfield, and actually, I just sourced this by Googling it, and I didn't realize I work with somebody that sits on zoning board in Springfield. And I said, hey, by the way, what's the deal with this permit thing with the commercial trucks? And he goes, yeah, we get them, we approve some and we deny some. He goes, we get a couple a month. It's not a great volume of permits in Springfield that come before their board. And it seems it's like, Dave, you were saying, in, you know, one neighborhood, you know, everybody's fine, they get along just fine. And in another neighborhood, you know, you have somebody who's bitching and complaining, and then they drill down to this ordinance and get a permit, and either they're denied that permit or they're furnished it. So, you know, I kind of, it's a little disappointing that we have to be a little bit more reactionary than proactive, but, you know, I think the way that our ordinance is, you know, now that it was brought to light or brought to our attention, you know, might be a bit outdated. And, you know, we do need to, I think, forge ahead and you know, try to modernize it in a way, but not to necessarily, you know, cater to a you know, a handful of people that, you know, want their trucks in their driveway or in the street when maybe it shouldn't be. So it's a delicate balance, I think.
Yeah, and I'd add, you know, the same concern about the permit. You know, well, I think, you know, to have everybody have to come and get a permit where you're just trying to address a couple of issues, you know, I think you're creating a lot of overhead, a lot of expense, which perhaps might not be necessary. And to get a permit, there's going to be certain criteria that's developed to approve it. So that same criteria could be, you know, if we just build out the ordinance with the same criteria, maybe that would be enough to kind of show people that are complaining. You know, at least, you know, if there is a little more specificity in the ordinance. You know, and I like what you said about the eye test, and basically, so it is a little difficult, but, you know, I think we should accommodate a lot of these vehicles to a certain extent. But I think if we just detail out the ordinance more, I think that might do the trick, at least for now, until we see, like, greater volume.
Yeah, so we're kind of talking on two levels. Right. You know, there's the permit issue. Should it be permitted or not? But even if you do have one, you still have to come.
You have to know what vehicle.
You still need some kind of criteria. So you wouldn't get the permit unless you met X, Y, and Z. Do you need a permit or not? That's for you folks to decide, and eventually the township committee. But the crux of the matter is still what's permitted where. So whether you have permits or not, that's sort of secondary to, well, what are you permitted to do in the first place? What could you even get a permit for? So just to sort of retool again, there may be some that say you should not, and this does not apply to streets, but there are other sections outside of the land use ordinance. So it's a police power. You're not supposed to park things on the street. This is totally what this ordinance is about, is totally on the property, in the driveway, in front of the house. Now, one of the issues too, you know, we have varying, size was brought up before, I think, by Bob. Some neighborhoods are more tight than others. And in one of the cases, the gentleman who was last week, first of all, as you say, the garage is too small. He can't get in the garage. But he also doesn't have the ability to get around the back. In some towns that I've researched, you can't have it in front of the house, or you can't have it forward of the minimum setback that's required of the house. It's okay to put it in the side yard or the backyard, but in some of these neighborhoods, you're just not wide enough. You can't get to the side or the back. So if you say you can have a commercial or a construction vehicle, however we define it, but it has to be in the side or the backyard, which several towns do, all right, well, then you're still excluding certain people from having anything in the front yard. So, you know, I think it sounds like there's some consensus on this whole commercial versus non-commercial. Correct me if I'm wrong, that this still may be hard to define. Obviously, commercial plates or no commercial plates, that's the easiest way to go, but it doesn't cover everything. As you saw in those pictures, those little transit, the Ford right. Transit Connect, they're pretty small.
Right.
You see them on the street. And if they're not wrapped, if they just say so-and-so on the side, you don't even know it's a commercial vehicle. But the idea of, you know, commercial versus construction, that's pretty good. But we're still going to have to put some sort of quantitative factor on it. When is a vehicle a commercial vehicle versus a construction? There's the obvious ones. Dump trucks. We just had President's Day savings event
all month long. All right. Halftime.
You know, intermezzo.
We just had a bunch of obvious construction stuff on the Capitol. You know, the F-50, the Mason dump trucks, the big dump trucks. They're obvious. And that's where the problem is here, is like, where do you draw this line?
I think a van, a pickup truck of any size, to me, just using the eye test, is something that you could drive on put on a property. Mm-hmm. One F-150, 250, 350. I don't think a dump truck of any size realistic belongs. This is just my opinion. If someone brings it home for one day because he had it coming home from work and it's not there ever again, I mean, things happen. But as a habitual park, I think that dump trucks don't belong. The gray area is when you get into the larger box trucks, quite honestly, I think that's the, I can appreciate if some neighbor has to see a big box truck parked in front of his house, front neighbor's house, I could see where that might become realistically not somewhere that would belong. I would think that would belong in a yard somewhere. Because it's 12 feet, 15 feet long, it's 10 to 12 feet high, 10 feet wide. It's going to take up your whole driveway for the most part by itself. But I understand that some people, then if you have that truck home, taking it home, you're almost running your business out of your house. Counselor, I don't know if you're shaking your head. I don't know if that's good or bad.
A lot of this has developed out of the so-called creeping home business issue. I mean, there are clearly people who are required nowadays to take trucks home because they, they go to work or they go wherever they're going from home. You've also got a lot of people who are surreptitiously or not so surreptitiously running businesses out of the house, especially in this day and age of internet, et cetera. And that's, in a lot of these towns, I will tell you that not only do they not want them in the driveway, they want them in the garage. And they want them in the garage after a certain hour and on certain days. And I know the West Orange one, for example, does that. And,
Well, those are usually more rural towns.
I'm not so sure I see West Orange as being all that rural.
Suburban or city type stuff. Or this is where
This is not only is it one of the best places to live, folks. This is a suburban town. I mean, yes, we have rural aspects too, but this town has grown significantly over the years, and there's a significant suburban aspect. And what you're starting to see is that push and pull of people who don't seem to have a problem versus people who moved out here to the country. It's not too dissimilar than many applications you all hear from the last one in who was told the next one isn't coming. And I didn't move to fill in the blank street to have it look like a parking garage for every, commercial vehicle known to man, whether it's PSE&G or, bakery or fill in the blank. So I mean,
how many realistically, how many complaints have we gotten where the end result was that the homeowner or was running their business out of their home? I mean, to me, it seems based on the last time I was here and the folks that spoke, the folks that came in from the community to speak, it sounds as though they're using their vehicles, specifically to get to and from work and to do their work for their business. It didn't really sound, I mean, I know we just had a small sampling, but it didn't seem to me that, they were running a business out of their home. So I'm just curious to know, in the past, have we ever had, a large quantity of complaints that have resulted in, folks having their business run out of their home?
Yeah, I don't know anything numbers-wise, but that often is the crux or the basis for some of these commercial vehicle ordinances. Mm-hmm. We do have sections of the ordinance that apply to home occupations. They are permitted. The whole idea of a home occupation, I think, is impact.
Outdated.
it's impact. I mean,
right.
All right. There are and the home occupations that we do permit are such that. Usually not these. Well, I mean, it might be, you're going to have one soon. A therapist wants to have an office.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So you've got people coming and going. You might need, there's some parking requirements, et cetera.
Right.
Quite not, my father had his own milk route. He ran the business off the kitchen table. There was no cars. There was no customers. Mm-hmm. He happened to have, because we lived in Jersey City, there was no such thing as a driveway. I didn't learn what that was until I went to college. Mm-hmm. So he had a rented garage. But so running a business in a house, at least from my perspective, I mean, if you literally, you're on the phone or, I use an electrician at home, he comes to your house. You don't go to his house. He comes to your house and he gives you a quote and draws things up. So this idea of yes, technically you're not supposed to run a business out of a house, but it, to me it's a kind of an impact question.
Right.
If you don't have people coming and going, you don't have people parking, you're not selling anything
right.
from
affecting.
There. You're answering the phone and you're making the books out.
Right.
Most people are working out of their car anyway, not even out of their home anymore.
Yeah. Anyway, like you say, with computers, I mean, you don't need an office per se, unless, you know, we're not talking showrooms.
Right.
You
understood.
Know, that kind of stuff. That's different.
And I don't think that was my intent. I think the answer is when we're starting to see these happening, it's becoming more and more businesses are downsizing their places of business.
The brick and mortars are going away.
Brick and mortar businesses in a lot of these trade situations are slowly coming to an end. It's simply easier to give somebody a phone and a truck and supplies, and many of you who have been here more than a month or so, we've had applications coming in here and the questions get asked, what's the truck traffic, where are the trucks going, you know, all of those things, because this is what...
And that's for guys trying to make a brick and mortar store.
Right. Are those people parking all night? No, they're taking them home. Well, what are they taking them home to? They're taking them home to somebody's house.
And I agree. I just feel like maybe then that's just indicative of the time that we live in, right? And that might mean that the ordinance has to change. You know what I'm saying? Like to kind of keep up with the times. I know that that sounds so simplified, but if people are utilizing phones and their ability to run their business out of their truck or whatever, you know, we might want to consider just, you know, at least a slight amendment to the ordinance or change to the ordinance.
You have all... without spending 4 hours doing this, you have all encompassed very quickly and very smartly all of the multiple problems
right.
that those of us who draft these fill-in-the-blank ordinances have been having over the years. The biggest one, frankly, is the one that the chairman alluded to. What is a commercial vehicle? It used to be easy. You had commercial plates. It was a commercial vehicle.
Right.
Now you don't have to have commercial plates to have a commercial vehicle. And what's too big and what's too small? And I don't envy anybody trying to do these, and I've drafted several of them over the years. There's no right answer. You're not going to...
So if we took the ordinance we had right now, David, which essentially the gray area seems to be the capacity of the vehicle, right?
Pretty much, yeah.
And we change that to a more definitive language as to the type of vehicle... And left the rest of it.
Or the gross vehicle weight.
Right.
Well, we're on GVW now, but it's only...
No, we're on tonnage.
Well, I'm saying we'd have to bump it up.
Yeah. But go to a GVW format.
Because a larger box van is going to have a large... Now, is it registered gross vehicle weight or is it posted gross vehicle weight?
Should be registered GVW.
No, because you can register for less than the truck is. So, for example,
that's true.
To get a commercial, like, see, at a CDL, you have a truck that will hold 32,000 pounds, but you don't want to have it to have a CDL driver. You will register the GVW
right.
lower.
You're right.
So that you do not. But now these trucks are much larger, obviously. But you could take, say, for example, an F450 pickup or whatever that would be way up there and register it lower. But so if you would go on the posted,
you're right. You're right.
GVW.
Yeah. Guy who delivers helium balloons can register his thing for like nothing.
Air's light.
Yeah. Potato chips.
So if we did that and then left the rest of the ordinance and then I don't know, without getting rewriting the whole thing, does that make sense and to start or is it a redo? I mean. From someone who has to enforce it, is the rest of the ordinance, in your opinion, enforceable if the vehicles are more defined?
The proposed ordinance? Yeah, well, just a really quick review, see if it hits all the points we talked about. Okay, so first of all, I guess, though, the way we define a commercial vehicle, and in the draft, in the proposed, any vehicle registered as a commercial vehicle, et cetera, Eric alluded to this earlier, or containing advertising matter intended to promote the interest of any business, whether or not said vehicle is registered as a commercial vehicle or not, excepting passenger cars, which are exempt from this provision. So if you had a Domino's pizza car, it wouldn't count. So there again, it's using that commercial plate, but if not a commercial plate, if it had a lot of advertising on it, it would be considered part of this. B is pretty straightforward, just whatever it is, you're only allowed one, commercial truck or van. But then we get into the payload capacity, or be it GVW, whatever it is, that's the question that has to be answered, or less. It's permitted to be parked out of doors overnight, subject to the following conditions. And I think the conditions are not too onerous. It has to be owned by the resident.
Right.
Now, number 10 is a condition that could affect the front yard question. You can't park it any closer to a street than the minimum setback requirement for the principal building, and no closer than 10 feet from a side or rear property line. We could reduce that. I mean, if indeed you want to permit trucks, however they're defined, in a front yard on the driveway but in front of the house, you wouldn't want to use the minimum setback requirement for the principal building because you're going to be in front of the house. So we could strike that. The vehicle shall be screened by fencing, landscaping, etc. Can't be parked on the grass or lawn, that's okay.
I hate to play lawyer, but I don't have grass and I don't have a lawn because I like decorative stones. Can I park my truck because it's not a grass or lawn area? Well, you don't want them parking in on the front property
other than a paved driveway.
I don't have a paved driveway. I have a
designated driveway area.
Yeah, you don't want them. I guarantee you, folks, not because this is what I do, but people like to play lawyer or else on grass. Mm-hmm. I don't have a paved driveway. I can park it anywhere. My whole front lawn is a driveway.
Yeah, reasonably defined driveway area.
He was playing lawyer.
I wish you all before Judge Richardson. not because John doesn't, but those are the kinds of things you see people getting up here and doing exactly. Well, Your Honor, it wasn't. My driveway isn't paved.
So what's the fix?
The fix is to try to broaden beyond the grass. I think basically on the front property. You want to park in front of the house. I think it's the objection. You don't want them on whatever you might consider a lawn or in a place where it's not where you would normally consider a driveway.
We could say it has to be on a paved surface. We still need to get into whether or not it's allowed in front of the house or not.
Do we allow unpaved driveways in the township?
If you have impervious surface.
Yeah, if you have a gravel driveway, okay. Well, that needs some. We could play. We could play a little.
Designated driveway.
That could. We'll have to do some wordsmithing. Number 4 is pretty straightforward. No business or sales can be conducted from the vehicle when it's parked there. The outside storage of any materials or equipment associated with the vehicle is prohibited. That's pretty straightforward. Now. All other vehicles, commercial vehicles, with the exception of those prohibited below, shall be stored within a permanent structure totally enclosing the vehicle subject to the applicable conditions in above. And that gets into, again, payload or GVW, whatever you want to do. So what it's doing is it's setting a max on a vehicle that can be parked outside. If it's between that and another max, you can have it, but it has to be inside a garage of some sort. If it's over, and then we get into more of the construction type stuff. So in D, commercial vehicles with a rated, in this case, payload capacity exceeding 2 tons, non-recreational trailers, construction equipment, truck tractors, and buses are prohibited in residential zones. So they're inside or outside. You get to a certain point, they don't belong there at all.
Right.
So I think that's, again, with the exception of the metric, payload capacity versus GVW, the intent of that section is there. And again, E, no more than one commercial vehicle of any type can be stored. That's pretty straightforward.
Right.
And lastly, it basically exempts agricultural property, so you can have whatever you need on there. So I think as we go through this again, it's how big is too big?
So one
and what's
ton.
What's commercial versus construction?
So 1 ton outside, 2 tons inside. In short, really.
Well, is 1 ton too small?
No, it says new section.
Down below.
The proposal is 1 ton inside, one ton outside, 2 tons.
But an F-250.
Right.
F-250's 2 tons.
Are you talking about payload?
Payload.
This is payload capacity, and if you look at the table, if you still have it. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So just so you know, so that small transit connect, the maximum payload capacity was under a ton, actually. The Ford Transit, the big van, the 2.28 ton capacity. And the Ford F-150 ranged, depending on how you fitted it out, I guess from 3/4 ton to 1.5 ton payload capacity.
An F-350 was the most common large pickup truck.
350?
An F-350 that would still be the same length, body, footprint of an F-150, 250, 350, for example. It just has beefier springs so it can hold more payload.
So
if you want to, you know, again, once you get above that, I'm getting out of commercial, I'm getting into construction. I guess what I'm saying.
So I think we get back to what Chairman was saying earlier, that eye test. And, right. And you folks, I'm not a truck guy. I only play one on TV. So, you know, is it GVW? And using your eye test and what you know about trucks, when is a truck too big? When does it become into that sort of construction category where you look at it and go, what's that doing there? Mm-hmm. So I don't know. Looking for your guidance on, it sounds like you're talking GVW.
Well, I think that sets a point where you get to a vehicle that's so big that it's not an everyday drive back to forth type vehicle.
And can we say something? We're still getting more specific to say, like, construction type vehicle, bigger than an F-350, let's say, for example. And well, it's still going to be gray
areas for enforcement.
But you got to have a gray area.
What does that mean? So, you know, you have vans that are going to be hold just a certain payload because they're only going to fit so much in a regular utility van type. And they're F-350 bodies, truck bodies, with vans on the back. So their payload is going to be about the same as an F-350 pickup. So
what do we do about the large recreational trailer?
That's for another night.
The big RVs that park in people's driveways?
Mm-hmm. Which are bigger in many
places. Bigger in many places, take up way more spot?
Yeah, and that's for another night, but yeah, we don't really say much
of
anything
about boats too?
Recreational trailers and boats, and other than that you can't live in them, that's about all we say. So, but that's, we'll have to address that.
Are they allowed in the front of the house versus maybe allowed if they're on the side of the house or in the back?
Basically not addressed.
But you would think if they're on the side
I'm
or the back.
Not looking to create bigger problems.
Come on, let me finish the first step here,
yes,
Counselor.
Yeah. I was pointing out that you sort of mentioned the non-recreational
He's playing lawyer.
Trailers.
Yeah.
We're sending Dave back to the drawing board.
Yeah.
I think we go back with the drawing board and then
correct the drawing board.
We go with maybe some stuff.
I
payload of whatever 350 would be and the size of a pickup truck and van.
I did suggest to Dave that you also have a conversation with PD.
Yeah, sure.
To see if they have any thoughts, because obviously they're going to end up, if this goes through, they're going to end up having to deal with it.
Enforce it.
They're going to have to enforce it. And frankly, if the chief has some thoughts on it, this might be the time to hear from him.
Yeah.
The permitting thing, not to say that that's not a bad idea, just allows maybe if someone does call the complaint, they can pull up the address and say, oh, we have a permitted vehicle on the spot, an F-150 pickup with this name on it, it's permitted to be there, and then no, it doesn't have to go out to actually see to write the ticket, because it saves the trip.
But they could also pull up the ordinance and say, you know, it's an F-150, so they're permitted. The ordinance
says
they're permitted.
Yeah, I guess it's
I know, and then you don't have to get a permit for all the other 100 or 200 trucks that...
Yeah, and the only problem there, I guess, and from what I've understood from the discussion, an F-150, there's an F-150 and then there's an F-150. So if you say you're an F-150 is allowed, and there's so many model designations, and it...
Well, to use the thing, if you make someone get a permit every 5 years, maybe at that point they'll decide they don't want to have that truck in there. in your driveway.
So do we have at least a consensus on GVW versus load capacity? Is that a more, a better measurement?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, and do we have, are we talking, well, I don't think we're talking one ton anymore, because that was really load capacity, which is a smaller measurement than the GVW. So are we talking, well, the Ford Transit, for instance, that large van, the gross vehicle weight is 5.18 tons, the full-size one. So, you know, how high do you want to go here? The biggest F-150, and this is all from the Ford website, by the way, these specs, the 3.92 gross vehicle weight, 3.92 tons for the largest F-150. So you don't have to decide that now, but we'll go with gross vehicle weight, and we'll leave a little blank, and we can figure that one out.
We're going to have to the township committee anyway, and they could completely change.
Oh, yeah, you could just say here.
They could just shelve it and say we're not doing anything. But
mail that one in, yeah.
It goes, round file it. But I think, you know, I think it at least gives them maybe a constructed view of our food for thought and how to narrow it down, mm-hmm. and then they can maybe massage it after what they think. But I think as long as, from your standpoint, if it's defined enough to make it enforceable, I think is really what we're striving for here, and also for the public to understand what is and is not acceptable.
Right. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Any comments from the public?
Sure.
Okay, we'll open to public on our testimony. Okay, second. Okay. You're sitting here, I figured you're interested in what do you got?
Susan Gull, Fort Hunt Club Road. Get my own chair. No, there's a few things. In the 80s, when I first went to work for the police department, newly minted degree, being trained as a dispatcher, one of my very first calls that I took was for a school bus parked on the side of the road up on the mountain. The dispatcher training me said, "This is a great call. You don't have to do anything. You just refer them right to the township." And that's what we did. So that took care of a lot of calls. But the other thing was, with cars parked on the side of the road, and the other thing was ones that aren't long enough. Even now up on Conover, the driveway is not long enough, and sometimes they stick out and block the sidewalks, which was just kind of a pain in the neck. You'd walk out in the road until the night I really banged my shin on one of the truck hitches from a landscaping truck sticking out across the sidewalk. And after that, I said, this is really bad. Also, are there New Jersey motor vehicle laws? For example, a truck parked on the side of a road that's wide enough to interfere with the lane of travel that you might be able to move it over to something like that. And as the condos being, what we used to do on that, condos were private property, refer them to their homeowners association. Some of the actual condos had a parking area because they wanted a slightly larger parking space anyway for some of these trucks. And they would have something at the end of one of their parking lots where several trucks could be accommodated. I see there's one under the, is it Farm Road?
Out
under the high tension wires, yes. Where they actually have, looks like RVs, trucks, things like
boats
that.
And stuff. Correct.
That I believe that belongs to one of the associations, and they've accommodated their residents by doing that. So that's something else. It's private property, can't help you.
Thank you, Susan. Good comments.
So do you want just to come back here, or do you want to just send something to the township committee, or what?
I think we'll come back here with what you've done, and we'll put a bow on it.
Okay.
And send it up.
All right.
Thank you, David.
All right.
All right. So in your packet, there was a correspondence from the Wastewater Management Planning Workshop, which I believe is already over.
Yeah.
So you can disregard that.
Darn it.
And after that, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Just Mr. Chairman, a quick review.
Hold on, Sally.
Next meeting is March 2nd.
right?
You have several applications on that night, and then we also have March 9th. From there forward, March 23rd forward, we actually have empty agendas at the moment, but they may fill up as we go forward. So you do have the two meetings, March 2nd and March 9th.
Okay.
Okay. Now I will entertain motion to adjourn.
Yes. So moved.
Any second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned.
Thank you.
All right.